Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Oh, good evening, everyone. It's good to see everyone here this evening. So why don't we begin with a prayer, and then we're going to dive in. So buckle your seatbelts. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for this day. We ask you to be with us, to help us to recognize your presence, to help us be open to the great mystery of this greatest prayer of the church, the Mass that you have given us, the Mass that is your great gift to us of your presence fully in the Eucharist. Lord, we ask all this, and we especially implore your help for the people of Ukraine, for all those people who are suffering and struggling in the world this day. And we ask all this through the intercession of Mary, Our Lady of the Fields, as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So really quick, I'm going to put on my cincture before I start, because I'm afraid I'm going to move around too much, and then you won't be able to hear me. So as I'm putting it on, I guess I'll get started. So I want to take us all back to the beginning of mankind. Great place, right? And at the very beginning, people were created in the image and likeness of God, right? We believe people are created in the image and likeness of God, and therefore they're desiring connection with God, right? We are each desiring a deep and profound union with God. It's deep within us, right? And we don't feel fully satisfied or fully at peace until we find rest in our Lord. Right? So people were struggling, and they were struggling to figure out, okay, how do we connect with this God, this one who created this mystery around us, right? They started wondering, well, where did all the nature come from? Where did all the weather come from? Where did these realities come from in our midst? So they began to figure out ways to try to connect with the one from which all of these things came. And what did they begin to do? They began to respond to what they felt they should do and offer sacrifices. So they started offering sacrifices. They started offering sacrifices to the divine to have good weather, to allow their crops to grow, all of these ways in which they were connecting with God through sacrifice. Through sacrifice. Fast forward, the Old Testament. We see in the Old Testament that every time God makes a promise with his people, that he makes a promise with Moses, that he makes a promise with Noah, that he's going to care for us and be with us, what do each of those people do? They offered a sacrifice. They offered a sacrifice to connect with God and to give thanks to God. Now, their sacrifice was an animal that they slaughtered and put on the altar and had to drain the blood. And okay, I won't go into too much more detail, but they offered a particular type of sacrifice. But this was the highest form of connection that they could have with God. And they desired to do that because of all that God was giving them. God gave them so much and promised them so much that all they could do was turn to him and give him thanks and praise. And this notion of sacrifice is what they did to offer that thanks and praise to God. So fast forward again to Jesus, who is the ultimate sacrifice. He's the one who told us, oh, thank God, we don't need to slaughter an animal and bring in and place it on this altar, right? The Lord was the ultimate sacrifice of sacrifices. And we'll come back to that in a little bit. But it's important to keep in mind that this notion of sacrifice is central to the Mass. It's central. It's central to everything we understand the Mass to be. It's central to why we come to Mass. It's central to why Jesus was sacrificed himself for us. So again, as I mentioned a little bit, or briefly, this notion of holiness, This notion of holiness is deep union with God, deep union with God. So everything in the Mass is oriented toward us growing in deep union with God. It's not oriented towards us taking a nap. It's not oriented towards us necessarily being fully excited or joyful all the time. It's a deep union with God that He is desiring with us, and we are desiring with Him. So before we go into some of the specifics of the Mass, I wanted to go over what the priest wears, because I've heard questions very often about this reality. So first, the priest wears an alb. And as you're going to see, the altar servers also wear albs, as we know. Yeah, Declan's one. He's sitting right there. But the priest wears an alb. And the alb is to remind the priest and all of you of our baptism. It's reflective of the white garment that we receive at baptism. And it's, again, reminding us, the priest, and all of you, of the significance of our baptism that linked us to God in a very intimate and unique way. Then there's the cincture, which I already put on. And I guess I'll take it back off to show you. But the cincture is pretty much used as a belt now. But originally, so you see the altar servers have cinctures as well. Now, it's optional for priests to wear, not because the meaning of it is optional, but it's just by nature of how things have evolved over time. But the cincture is meant to be, it's a holdover, it's a continuation of the notion, the aesthetic movement a little while ago, of wearing kind of a chastity belt, if you will, to remind people, so the priest wears it, to remind him of his commitment to chastity and celibacy. Basically, for the young ones in the midst, a commitment fully to the church, right? So a priest isn't married, not dating anyone, I'm not pursuing that, but I am. It's a reminder to me that I'm fully committed to the church, right? So again, it comes from the roots of the chastity belt and holding firm to growing in chastity and celibacy. So then we have two other things that the priest wears. So the first one is called a stole. And if you've seen pretty much all leaders around the world, you might see them wearing some form of a stole. Because a stole is a sign of authority, right? It's a sign of authority. So even non-Catholic or non-Christian leaders might be wearing stoles in certain realms or arenas. But it's a sign of authority. But when the priest wears it, obviously, it's a reminder that this is not his authority. He's not doing this based, I'm not doing this based off of my own will. It's the Lord's authority, Jesus' authority, working through me, his power working through what I say and what I do up here, that allows this great mystery to happen, right? So it's all about the priest's authority. The final thing, which I think has the most beautiful symbolism, it's called the chasuble. So the chasuble, obviously, you all see us wear chasubles. We wear them different colors, all different seasons, right? So I'm going to have to start wearing purple soon because Lent's coming. But this is the chasuble. And I heard one time it described as when the priest puts on the chasuble, he's putting on all of the people, all of your intentions, all of your worries, all of your cares, all that you're coming here with. And he's carrying all of that with him to the altar to offer that to God, right? It's a really beautiful reminder for me when I put on the chasuble that I'm bringing all of you with me in a very unique way up to the altar to offer all of you, and myself included, all of us, to the Lord, to unite us closely with the Lord. So again, it's we have the alb, the stole, the cincture, the chasuble. And again, all of these are reminders for the priest, but they're also important reminders for all of you of the way that we are all called to pursue holiness. Right? How we're all called to pursue holiness. So I wanted to say something really quick about entering the church, obviously you have the tradition of receiving holy water. Again, it's been another controversy in which people have brought to my attention that we still do not have holy water. But during Lent, traditionally, churches have emptied their holy water fonts at the doors. So we'll be bringing holy water back as soon as we wrap up Lent. It reminds us of that desert of Lent that we're entering into. But we have the baptismal font there. And when we come in and we dab our fingers in the water, it's a reminder to us of our baptism. But what's interesting about the design of the church is we put baptismal fonts in a location either, in some churches they're in the front, right, when you walk in. Some churches they're lower, off to the side, because it's meant to symbolize that in order to get to the altar, we have to come through the waters of baptism, right? So everything here, including every motion and movement in the Mass, has a meaning and a rhythm and a purpose, right? So even the design of churches has a meaning and a purpose. So again, we kind of solidified that as a baptistry, and we did that as an important element of reminding us of going through the waters of baptism to the altar. Right? So the role of the priest in Mass, I'm in persona Christi, so the Lord is working through me. So my words are not necessarily my own. They're my own, but they're not my own. But they're my own, but they're not my own. You get it. So I'm in the person of Christ, right? And you're going to notice in a little bit, I'm going to point out a time when the wording of the prayer shifts from me speaking to Christ speaking, to me talking about God, to him speaking through me. So it's a really powerful movement in the Mass. So for what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the first part of the Mass, and then we're going to celebrate Mass. Does that make sense? And then I'll bring up, I didn't want to be too choppy with how I talked about Mass and break up the Mass too much. So the entrance procession, as we see every time we come to Mass, it's usually a cross, altar servers, deacon, priest, and in the front is usually incense. And the incense, that's used to symbolize our prayers rising up to God, but also we're actually supposed to use enough incense that it actually kind of blurs our vision. It blurs our vision around the altar and what we can see to remind us of the great mystery that's happening. We're not supposed to see fully what's happening, right? We're supposed to see with the eyes of our heart, not just the eyes, our physical eyes, right? So we ask the Lord to help us enter into that, and the blur of this incense kind of helps remind us that, yeah, the Lord is becoming present here, and we need to open our hearts up to him. So obviously the priest offers the sacrifice of the Mass on behalf of the people, but all of you are participants in the sacrifice. So it's a kind of a, it's a two-way street, right? So we, the priest, will offer the sacrifice, and all of you join with the priest in responding to the prayers, etc. Something really important to remember is the back and forth in Mass, right? The priest says things, you say things back. The priest says things, you say things back. It's meant to symbolize the dialogue between you and God, right? The dialogue that's needed. In a disposition of listening, we have to listen to the word, but also he asks us to respond. Respond with our lips, our hearts, but also respond with the way we live. So it's such an important reminder to us as we enter into the Mass. So we begin Mass with the sign of the cross in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And what's significant here is that we are beginning Mass in his name, not ours. From the very beginning, we're reminding ourselves that this is about God. This is about us seeking to unite ourselves with God. So it's programming us to enter in to the divine mystery. In a sense, it's kind of branding us, and it's reminding us every time we do the sign of the cross that he's present and that we're entering into that mystery. Because literally, as we do the sign of the cross, we're surrounding ourselves with the Trinity, right? We're surrounding ourselves every time when we pray, and when, especially when we come to Mass. This is a beautiful thing that I heard from Bishop Barron. When the priest begins with, "The Lord be with you," and how do you respond with your spirit? That basically, There's a big controversy, of course, when it shifted to that, right? It shifted away from "and also with you," and shifted to "and with your spirit." I found it more beautiful in a sense, especially now, and Bishop Barron kind of reminded us in his Mass study that when you say "and with your spirit," all of you are reminding me of who I am as a priest. You're reminding me that the Lord is actually in me and working through me and leading all of you in prayer. So it's a beautiful kind of relationship that fosters just by saying that exchange. The Lord be with you. I'm saying the Lord is with you, and you're reminding me of my role. So you can hold me accountable. And then we shift into the penitential rite, where we turn to the Lord and ask for his mercy. Now what's important is this doesn't take the place of confession. This does not take the place of confession. This is a moment when we're supposed to recognize our brokenness and our sinfulness. Because as all of you know, when we recognize, if we don't recognize our brokenness and our sinfulness, it's a lot harder to be open to God because we're struggling with pride, right? We're struggling to acknowledge the reality of our life. And we plead, "Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy," because we're begging God. This isn't like just kind of saying this for fun or kind of hoping God forgives us. We're actually supposed to be begging him. Like, this is a form of begging him as our king, as the one who can truly forgive us. And it's a reminder to us also, it's in there, it's in at the beginning of Mass, also because the blind man Bartimaeus, what did he cry out? He cried out, "Son of God, have pity on me, a sinner. Son of God, have pity on me, a sinner." And what happened after he cried out? His sight was restored. His sight was restored. So what happens if we cry out, "Lord, have mercy, forgive us. Lord, have mercy, forgive us. We're sinners." Well, we pray that our sight will be restored and we can truly see the Lord in our midst. Right? We can truly be with him. So recognizing our sin at the beginning of Mass is crucial. But we don't stay there, right? On Sunday Mass, we go to the Gloria. And the Gloria is praising God and giving thanks to him. And then we go to the collect after that. So after we praise God for giving us forgiveness, we go to the collect, which is this opening prayer, right? So the opening prayer is called the collect because it's literally collecting us all together as one. It's saying, okay, we've recognized our sinfulness. We've given praise to God together in the Gloria. But now we're all gathered together and we're about to hear his word. We're about to hear him, God, speaking to us through the powerful means of Scripture. Really beautiful. So in the collect, there's an address to God, there's an acknowledgement of his deeds, there's a petition, and then there's a concluding formula, you know, through Christ our Lord, or et cetera, et cetera. So it's a means to, again, enter us in. Everything is leading us up a mountain. Everything is a slow forming of our disposition to reach the pinnacle at which Christ becomes present here on this altar. Everything. But we kind of lose sight of that, right? Because we come in with a lot of stuff, we're distracted, we kind of are just in a zone, and we're kind of going through the rote movements. But this is meant to lead us to an encounter with the Lord. We're walking slowly up a mountain that we're going to reach the pinnacle of soon in the Mass. So soon enough, we're going to start Mass soon. But after the collect, we have the liturgy of the Word. And we know the readings, right? And today we're going to have a daily Mass, so it's just going to be a first reading and a psalm. But the readings are picked for a certain reason, in certain ways, and they have a rhythm to them. And as hopefully you might know, the Old Testament reading usually corresponds to the Gospel. The meaning in the Old Testament usually corresponds to the Gospel. Then there's a psalm, then there's a second reading, often from the New Testament on Sundays, and then our Gospel from the book of the Gospels. So then we go into the homily, right? And the homily, the intention of the homily, is meant to be breaking open Scripture, helping us to understand the meaning of what we read and making sense of it in our daily life. That's the point of the homily, right? Now, sometimes we have to do the annual appeal for Catholic ministries or et cetera, et cetera. So that's when you pray and ask the Lord to have mercy on us priests. But ultimately, the homily is meant to kind of break open the complexity of what we heard and help guide all of you to enter into that story. Because the scripture can be very disconnected. It can feel very disconnected from our life. The homily is meant to link God's word, what we heard, to our life. Again, preparing our hearts, opening our hearts, helping us realize our need for him before we receive him. Right? It's really, really, really beautiful. So a quick word about the creed. Usually at Mass, we have the creed, the Nicene Creed. So the Nicene Creed, there were two creeds, the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed. If you look in the Gather Hymnal or whatever, I think they're both in there. But the Apostles' Creed was basically a list of teachings that were repeated by the first apostles. Right? So the first apostles, they gathered. Jesus died, he resurrected, he ascended. And they said, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Well, they formed these kind of sayings that everyone could say because they didn't necessarily have the full Mass yet, right? All of the prayers that we pray. But they had this kind of doctrinal statement that they would say when they got together to pray. And that's the Apostles' Creed. That's why it's called the Apostles' Creed, because it's from the very beginning. And then what happened was a guy named Arius in around the 300s, he said, wait, this guy Jesus, he's not divine, he's not God. He's too human to be God. So then all these people were like, what are you saying? You're crazy. But some people actually followed him. And in 325, they got together a big council, and they determined that Arius was a little loopy, but they had to find a solution to this. So they added more lines into the creed, into the Apostles' Creed, to make it the Nicene Creed, which is what we pray at Mass. That's why we have the words like consubstantial and all those higher level theology words in there. They were put in there basically to teach, to remind us that Jesus is God. So in a sense, it was kind of like the 49, or whatever the number was, the theses that Martin Luther put on the door, right? It was kind of like a statement, like a fighting statement, like, no, this is the truth. This is what we believe. And we say that every Mass, right? Or every Sunday Mass. It's so beautiful. And then we go into the universal prayer that after we've been fed by God's word, after we have confidence and courage and know that God is with us and we're part of his story, we then offer specific prayers to him. So a quick word about the altar before we kind of dive a little bit into Mass. But this altar in particular is a beautiful one. In our church, Our Lady of the Fields, we know that we have many names for churches, right? St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, St. Joe's. We have all these churches around. But the question is, where did that come from? Where did that come from? Well, the Christians in the early church were being martyred. And as they were being martyred, their bodies were taken and being burned. But the Christians said, no, we need to fight for these people. We need to keep these people. We need to protect these people. So they went and got the people. They went and found the people who had died and buried them secretly under the ground. And if you've ever been to Rome or you've ever heard, they're called the catacombs. So there's like seven stories of different spaces where bodies were, all the way down under the ground. I've been there, and it's creepy. But they used to have bones in there, but they took them out because people started stealing them. I would have taken one, but nice relic. But they go all the way down. So what they would do, the Christians, because they were afraid that they were going to get killed, they would go in the catacombs, and they would be together, and they would pray. And they would open up the word. They would reflect on what Jesus had taught them, right? They had letters, they had some things. They didn't have like a Bible per se, right? But they had some memories of him, and they would share those memories, and then they would do what Jesus told them to do. They would break bread, right? And sip wine that was prayed over and blessed. They would do what Jesus told them to do. So from the very beginning of the church, they would go down and be with these martyrs, these saints, and offer what we now know as the Mass. It's so powerful to think about, because that's what draws us to today. In this altar, we have relics. We have relics, and no one really knows, but I think it's St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, a relic of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. So in the altar, if you come up and you can see, if you ever had the chance to look, underneath there's a stone and there's a relic in there. And that's because it's a reminder to us that whenever we celebrate Mass, we are in the presence of saints. We are in the presence of the angels and saints. The early Christians had a physical experience of that, literally celebrating a Mass or praying and being with the saints of their time. And we now have also a physical presence, but in a different way, a relic in the altar and the angels and saints, we believe, spiritually present with us, lifting up our souls and lifting up our hearts to the Lord. So as we now hear a word about music and then enter into this sacred liturgy, let us view each step. Let's try to view each step leading up through the liturgy of the word, the first part of the Mass, as kind of climbing up a mountain, leading us to a point that we can be open to the Lord's presence. So after Alex speaks a few words about music, we're going to enter into the Mass, and then I'll share more a little bit later.
Well, good evening. I am the magical voice from the rear. My name is Alex Ashman. I'm the director of music, and I just wanted to touch base with you and share a little information on why we sing. I think that's probably several topics of a doctoral thesis or a book out there, why we sing. So why do we sing? Well, we sing just as Father Matt said in his beautiful opening. It's a response. We're constantly in dialogue with God in the Mass, whether we are praying responsively or we're singing. Singing the opening or the entrance song is a direct correlation to what we just talked about, where the early Christians and the very essence of the beginning of Mass were sort of done in hiding and done in quiet. And they really couldn't sing because they were trying to hide. And now that we fast forward 2,000 some years later, when we begin Mass, we have the cross and the procession, we have all the people taking part, walking down the aisle and proclaiming, "We are here." It's like a victory parade. We are celebrating the fact that we are gathering together to worship God. And so we sing to elevate our emotion, elevate our joy of being together in this higher form of making noise than just speaking, in singing. And how many of you actually pay attention to the words that you're singing of the songs? Be honest. Oh, I think some of you need to go to confession. Well, but that's good. The words of the songs that we sing play an important part, because just as we are in dialogue with God in the Mass, the music is in dialogue with the liturgy. What is the liturgy? The liturgy is the readings. The liturgy is the order of what we do and how we do it. So the words of each song are carefully picked and planned to correspond, to be in dialogue with the readings of that particular day, whether it's a daily Mass or whether it's Sunday or Christmas Eve or so on and so forth. So there's a lot of important theology that is, just like a creed is a reminder, it's a teaching. We sing, just like the Who's in Whoville, the young and the old, the tall and the short, they're all together singing. We're singing to both joyfully welcome ourselves into Mass, to gather to praise the Lord, but we're also remembering and teaching of the theology that is in the readings that we're about to partake, and then the liturgy of the Eucharist to follow. Now, that's the opening song. We've talked about the next piece of music, the Gloria, which is a hymn of praise to God. Following that is the responsorial psalm. And that's, I call it the P psalm because it starts with the letter P. So the P psalm is a form of poetry. What is poetry? It's Hebrew poetry, and they were all written by one guy. Does anyone know who that is? David, as in King David, the guy who had his lyre, bring, bring, bring. I like to think of him prancing around in the fields, playing his lyre, and coming up with this poetry, what we now know is the Book of Psalms. So a poem, a song, anything you write down comes from your emotion. It comes from your response. You're responding to something by writing something down. So David was taking the word of God, taking his experience of God and his faith, and putting it into a psalm, into music, into sung words that we hearken to when we do the responsorial psalm, where we have a chance to make God's word our own. So the psalm is like a guide to think about, well, what did I just hear in the first reading, and what might I hear in the second reading, and how is that tying to the gospel? So I like to think of it as sort of a bridge. So that's pretty much all the music we do besides the Alleluia, which we all know, in the first part of the Mass. So we will now partake in the singing of the entrance hymn. So if you could all rise. And you can always look to your right over to the hymn board where we have the numbers. The numbers are always in order. The first hymn is number 742, The Church is One Foundation. And the text that we read, the church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. And think about when the music gets high, and what words are with the higher parts, and what words are with the lower parts. Because it's really important that the sounds we sing help bring out the words that we're singing along with those sounds. So let's joyfully sing number 742, The Church's One Foundation.
Church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From him he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth, one holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
In order to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. You have come to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that the course of our world may be directed by your peaceful rule, and that your church may rejoice untroubled in her devotion. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first letter of Saint Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gave us a new birth to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by the power of God are safeguarded through faith, to a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the final time. In this you rejoice, although now for a little while you may have to suffer through various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that is perishable, even though tested by fire, may prove to be for praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Although you have not seen him, you love him. Even though you do not see him now, yet you believe in him. You rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy as you attain the goal of faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord will remember his covenant forever. The Lord will remember his covenant forever. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart, in the company and assembly of the just. Great are the works of the Lord, exquisite in all their delights. The Lord will remember his covenant forever. He has given food to those who fear him. He will forever be mindful of his covenant. He has made known to the people the power of his works, giving them the inheritance of the nations. The Lord will remember his covenant forever. He has sent deliverance to his people. He has ratified his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. His praise endures forever. The Lord will remember. Jesus became poor, although he was rich, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up, knelt down before him, and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answered him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments, you shall not kill, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not defraud, honor your father and your mother." He replied and said to him, "Teacher, all of these I have observed from my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You are lacking in one thing. Go, sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At that statement, his face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words. So Jesus again said to them in reply, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for one who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were exceedingly astonished and said among themselves, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For men it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So on Saturday morning, the Gospel was about how we are supposed to be children in order to inherit the kingdom of God, be like children in order to inherit the kingdom. And what the Lord was reminding us is that we need to be dependent on him and trust him, to seek to be dependent on him and trust him. Well, today we meet someone, a man, who did all the right things on the surface level, but clearly Jesus was challenging him to say, "That's great, you do all the right things, but clearly you haven't given your whole self to me. You haven't given your whole self to the Lord." So what does he ask him to do? He asks him to give up his possessions. So I've been thinking about all day and about this reading about what did he mean by possessions, right? So in the reading, it obviously means he gave away stuff to the poor. But I think we can also reflect on that idea of possessions as the things we hold on to. Anger, resentment, bitterness, jealousy, all the fun things to do. But all those things we hold on to, if we think about it, we feel when we enter into those realities that we're distant from God, that we're not really uniting ourselves with him. So as we come to this Eucharist, as we come to be nourished by him, in order to be nourished by him, we first need to acknowledge those realities in our heart and in our life and give them to Jesus. Say, "Jesus, take this. Take my anger, take my bitterness, take my frustrations, take my anxiety, take my fear, and fill me up with you. Help me to live for you, really live for you." So I pray that as we come closer to our Lord this day, as we receive the Eucharist, that we can really, truly experience a deeper unity with him. Let us stand and continue to offer our prayers to God, our almighty and merciful Father. We pray for Pope Francis, our church leaders, all who lead and guide the mission of our church. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all of our elected officials. We pray for our country, the sanctification of our country. And we pray for an increased awareness of the dignity of life from conception to natural death. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all the people of Ukraine, for an end to violence and war, that peace may reign in our hearts, in our homes, and in our world. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are sick and suffering in mind, body, and spirit. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who have died and all those who will die this day. We pray for all of our loved ones who have gone before us. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray in a specific way this Mass for the staff here at Our Lady of the Fields. And we pray for all the special intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. O God, we turn to you in faith, hope, and trust. We ask you to hear our prayers, Lord, and answer them according to your will. Lord, we ask you to hear our prayers, especially through the intercession of St. Joseph and Mary, our mother. Amen. Please be seated. So we concluded the Liturgy of the Word. Now we're going to shift into the Liturgy of the Eucharist. And this is the peak. This is the peak that we're preparing our hearts for. We've been listening to the Lord. We've been listening to the Word of God. We're preparing our hearts fully to get to that peak, that top moment, the source and summit, where we can finally be with our Lord fully present on this altar. So a few things about what you're about to see. So when any priest goes over, we first hold up the bread and hold up the wine. At that point, it's bread and wine. These are elements of the earth. They come from what God has created, and he is renewing them. So what do you think he's doing with us? He wants us to come forward, who he has created, to renew us, right? It's a representation of what he's desiring to do in us as well. So the offering of gifts, what we did BC before COVID, the offering of gifts was brought forward, and that was to represent all of us coming to this altar, bringing our whole lives, our hearts. So during this time, as a song is sung usually, or maybe during daily Mass, as there's nothing, it's silent, it's a time to bring ourselves, say, Jesus, here's my junk. Here's my struggles. Here's my sufferings. Here's the things that I'm struggling with. Here's my joys, everything. And lay it on this altar. So there's beautiful prayers prayed. And how do we respond? Blessed be God forever. We give praise and thanks to God. It's beautiful. So then the priest will pray a prayer in silence. So I'll read it out loud. They're supposed to be private prayers. Because just as all of you are preparing to receive, the priest is meant to pray these prayers and ask the Lord to help prepare him to offer this sacrifice for all of you and with all of you. Does that make sense? So the prayer is, with humble spirit and contrite heart, may we, all of us, be accepted by you, O Lord, and may our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. So we're begging the Lord that this sacrifice will be pleasing to him. Then, before that, I'm sorry, with the chalice, you'll see me put the wine in and then a little dab of water. Right, if you pay attention, you'll see a little dab of water. That's to represent the divinity and humanity becoming one. It's a reminder, because when water goes into wine, you can't separate the two anymore, right? It's hard to separate them. So that comes from just a reminder to us and to the priest that this truly is going to be the Lord. This is going to be the Lord truly present to us in his humanity and divinity, which are so interconnected that we have a hard time fully understanding the beautiful mystery. So then I go over and I wash my hands again. That's representative of kind of a ceremonial washing. The Jewish people would wash their hands, would wash their whole bodies before they offered sacrifice. They would wash the animals and their bodies. So this is just a little symbolic act to remind me that I'm a sinner, and asking the Lord that in spite of my flaws, in spite of my sins, that he can still work through me to feed all of you. Right? It's so beautiful. So, of course, the priest as well then prays, wash me, Lord, of my iniquities, cleanse me of my sin. Right? Wash me, Lord, of my iniquities, cleanse me of my sin. It's beautiful. So when we come to this Mass, we come to this moment. We're about to enter in beautifully as the Lord becomes present. This is a moment when we remember the one sacrifice of Christ. This is important. Every Mass, we're not re-killing Jesus, right? Jesus is present to us, and we're recalling his presence, and in recalling, he becomes present. I was thinking the other day about how it's kind of similar to like when we have a very vivid dream, right? When we're dreaming, and we woke up, and we're like, whoa, that was like reality, right? That was like so, it felt so real, it felt so present to what to our experience. Well, it's kind of like that, but the thing is, this isn't a figment of our imagination. The Lord is being present to us in this reality, right? But he's that present to us. He's so present that we can experience him so fully. The challenge is us, right? We have to be open to where the Lord has brought us to get to this point. We have to be open to what he was saying to us, what he was reminding us of in Scripture, so that we can be open to really receiving him, really receiving him. So in this moment, we pray. Then we shift over to a preface, which prepares for the Eucharistic prayer. And there's four Eucharistic prayers, right? The one with all the saints, when the priest starts praying that and everyone says, oh gosh, this is going to be a long Mass. And then the second Eucharistic prayer, which is actually the shortest one, and that's what's usually heard at daily Mass. But that one is actually based on a prayer from a long, long time ago, from the 3rd and 4th century. So these are prayers that have been prayed for a long, long, long time. And they've been prayed at the Mass for many, 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 many years. But at the beginning of that preface, I say, the Lord be with you and with your spirit. Then I say, lift up your hearts. That means we're literally, you're saying that you are lifting your hearts up to that top of the mountain so that you can be one with Jesus. Right? I mean, we say it, but we don't really realize what we're saying, right? We're saying we lift them up to the Lord. We're lifting up our hearts. We're saying, okay, Jesus, this is the moment. Here we go. And then we're lifting us up to be one with Jesus. Right? It's beautiful. So that just as the bread and wine turns into the body and blood of Jesus, he's not just in the bread and wine. That becomes the body and blood of Jesus. When we receive him, we, therefore, are meant to be transformed as well. Again, those created things are transformed. Just as we created things, the Lord desires to transform us. So in praise, we pray, holy, 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 as Isaiah prayed on Mount Zion, a mountain himself. And we enter into the great mystery of the Lord being present to us and us doing what he told us to do, what he told us to do. Jesus says, Lazarus, come out. Jesus says, daughter of Jairus, rise up. He said, hey, do this in memory of me. He didn't say, well, consider it. No, he said, do it, right? So we're doing it. And he is becoming present to us. And then finally, we end with that mystery of faith before we enter into the rest of the Mass. And that mystery of faith proclaims the beauty of what the Lord has done for us and in us, and what he desires to do now that we have received him. And then we continue, we ask for the saints and all these people then to help us realize what we just received, who is present here. And then we prepare again, receive his presence, right? But then we ultimately prepare to receive him in the Eucharist when we come forward, which we'll talk about in a minute. So those pieces, those parts are sung. Alex, do you have any words to say about that briefly?
I do. So the parts of the Mass, which are referred to as a vocabulary word called the ordinaries, meaning the Gloria, the Holy, 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 the Memorial Acclamation, the Great Amen, and the Lamb of God, called the ordinaries, they are dialogues and litanies between us and God, taking part in the great Eucharistic prayer. And the reason we sing them is actually pretty straightforward, because they reflect the nature, the response back and forth, they reflect the nature of who God is in relation to us. God loves us and is always reaching out to us, and we are always responding. By singing the ritual dialogues that we do Mass after Mass, that's why we call them the ordinaries, they are always sung, We are reminding ourselves and teaching the catechumens and the children of God who God is and how God acts. These acclamations, these ordinaries, share a number one spot in the importance of if there were a hierarchy of music in the Mass. This is the most important music in the Mass because they are fundamental acts of praise and worship. In Scripture, it says all over the place to praise God with shouts of acclamation and just make lots of loud noise. So our gut-level instinct is to shout out with praise. So that's why these particular texts, the Holy, Holy, and so on and so forth, are always, always sung, because we are shouting out, we're calling out, we're praising the Lord. So yeah, that's pretty much it.
So as the altar is prepared, let us bring ourselves to the Lord. Let us reflect upon all of our worries, our challenges, our joys, and offer them in this moment.
Please join in singing number 728, Eye Has Not Seen, number 728.
Seen, ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. When pain and sorrow weigh us down, be near to us, O Lord. Forgive the weakness of our faith and bear us up within your peaceful word. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who provide gifts to be offered to your name and count our oblations as signs of our desire to serve you with devotion, we ask of your mercy that what you grant as the source of merit may also help us to attain merit's reward through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for although you have no need of our praise, yet our thanksgiving is itself your gift. Since our praises add nothing to your greatness, but profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord, and so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we acclaim.
Holy, holy, glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and William our Bishop, his assistant bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Our Lady of the Fields, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
We proclaim the great Amen because we believe that the Lord is present. The great Amen means I believe. I believe. We believe that he's present here in our midst. After metanoia, after actively remembering, falling in the line of our Jewish ancestors, who brought to mind the crossing the Red Sea and made it present in their life. We just brought to mind the mysteries of Jesus, and he chose, is choosing, to be with us here right now. So let us be open now as we, now together, as we're united in prayer with our Lord. What better prayer can we pray than the one that he taught us? So at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free and free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever." Now that we have prayed as one, we are called to share peace with one another. We are with our Lord. If I was with Jesus, well, we are with Jesus. When I'm with Jesus, I don't want to punch my brother or sister. I don't want to be aggravated with my loved one or be in a place of disrepair. So peace frees us. Sharing a sign of peace frees us from ourselves, the things that are holding us back, and unites us in a bond of love as the body of Christ. So Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Send them along to the different churches, and when they receive the body of Christ, when they see that little piece from the Pope, they place that piece in their chalice. So now it's a reminder to us of the unity of the body and blood of Christ, but it's also a reminder to us of the unity we have with the church at large. So when this is happening, I'll pray the prayers that we're supposed to pray in silent out loud so you can hear them. May this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy, be for me protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. As I receive the body and blood of Christ, I say to myself quietly, may the body and blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. A prayer for myself, but also a prayer that I encourage all of you to adopt. When we receive our Lord, may the body and blood of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. So as we receive the body and blood of Christ fully present in this Eucharist now, let us ask him to unite our hearts with him and more deeply unite us with one another as well.
As we receive communion, we sing a communion hymn. And the communion hymn has one sole purpose, and that is to express to us, the communicants, union in spirit by means of the unity of our voices, to show the joy of the heart and to highlight more clearly the nature of the procession to receive the Eucharist. So in the spirit of unity and being one, let us sing number 932, One Bread, One Body. Number 932.
Many through throughout the earth. We are one body in this one Lord.
We take a moment of silence now to really allow the Lord to enter deep within us as He just chose to enter us so beautifully in the Eucharist. Let us pray. Nourished by your saving gifts, we beseech your mercy, Lord, that by this same sacrament with which you feed us in the present age, you may make us partakers of life eternal. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We went up the mountain to reach the pinnacle. We lifted up our hearts to the Lord. At that moment, Jesus became present in the Eucharist, at the moment of those words of consecration, the moment when Emma, our server, she rang those bells. That was an indication that Jesus is here. He became present to us. And that moment, I was speaking in the words of Christ, and he became present to us. Then we receive him, as we just did. And now we're coming off the mountain. We're coming out of this time with God. So now it's our challenge every time we go to Mass, every time we go to Mass. The Lord comes into our life in a profound way. So the question is, how are we going to change? What's the resolution? What's a way we can choose to live differently when we walk out of these doors? We've encountered him. We've been up on the mountain. And now we're walking off and we're going forth. So I pray that every Mass we come to, we can be open to his presence, and we can be open to how he is trying to transform us. We just have to let him. Obviously, there's so much more to the Mass. There's probably things I forgot to say, and there's probably pieces that I skipped over. But if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. But it's a journey every time we come to Mass. There's so much more. There's so many books about the Mass. There's so many things to read about, ways to enter more deeply to connect with our Lord. But I pray this gives you a little glimpse of the power of this beautiful, most significant prayer in our church. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks
be to God. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. St. Joseph,
pray for us.
Our Lady of the Fields,
pray for us. Let us go forth in joyful celebration as we sing number 593, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light, number 593.
I want to walk as a child of the light. I want to follow Jesus. God set the stars to give light to the world. The star of my life is Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I want to see the brightness of God. I want to look at Jesus. Clear sun of righteousness, shine on my path and show me the way to the Father. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus.